One of Minecraft's greatest strengths is the wide range of creatures and enemies that are found throughout the world. They span the gamut, from mild-mannered villagers to explosive creepers to dark and powerful bosses. With so many possibilities, it can be easy to overlook some of the mobs that may initially seem less interesting. The Witch is an example of this. On first glance, there's really nothing special about them. But this line of thinking obscures an engaging story explaining who they truly are. There's more to the Witch than is immediately obvious. Welcome to Minecraft Deep Dive, a series where I explore some of the more interesting and obscure parts of the game. Tonight, we're going to be taking a look at the Witch, one of the few mobs with explicit magical capabilities. Hopefully, we'll be able to discover who they are and how they fit into the context of the world. Join me for a dive beneath the waves. The Witch is a hostile mob. They're the rarest in a group which I call the standard enemies. These are the mobs that spawn at low light levels in the overworld. They include well-known adversaries such as skeletons, zombies, and creepers. Although it's a diverse group, we can clearly split it up into categories. The first set is the natural mobs, mobs that don't have anything strange about them, and they might be found in nature. These include the spider and the creeper. The next group is the undead mobs, and this includes zombies, zombie villagers, skeletons, and the situational variants, such as the drowned and husks. In previous videos, I've talked about how these undead mobs imply that there used to be a humanoid species which was wiped out. Don't worry about the details of this. The point is that all undead mobs are in this group. Another standard mob is the Endermen, although these are a special case which require more complex reasoning to understand. Watch the video above to learn more. So, as we've just formalized, all standard enemies are either natural, undead, or Endermen. Well, almost all of them. The obvious question we need to ask is, where does the Witch fit into this? It's clearly not undead, as it doesn't take extra damage from smite. It's also not an Enderman, and it doesn't seem to be natural either. The Witch uses potions, which require crafting abilities to make. Categorically, the Witch is all on its own. No other standard enemy is quite like it. There's a specific place where witches can spawn, in addition to their standard spawn. They spawn upon generation of swamp huts, which rarely occur in swamp biomes. Swamp huts are structures which are elevated, providing protection from the water that's often found underneath. They provide a glimpse into the life of the witch, as they contain equipment, including a cauldron and crafting table. Overall, it's a pretty uninteresting structure. It does, however, offer an important clue about the witches. They have a home base. They're not just wandering the world aimlessly. Rather, there's a place where they do their brewing. There's a clear parallelism between witches and villagers. Both are extremely similar in appearance, including the same height, a characteristically large nose, and folded arms. The swamp hut is similar in size to a villager's house, and it utilizes solid wood supports on the corners as would be found in a village. It spawns a black cat as well, similar to the clouders of cats found on the village streets. The hut even has a workstation of sorts with a cauldron and crafting table. These similarities are far more prominent than that of the illagers. As explained in a previous video, illagers seem to be extremely far removed from the villagers, both in their architecture, leadership structure, and the way that they act. That's not the case for witches. In fact, it seems as though witches are almost villagers, or at least very closely related. The dynamic between witches and villagers offers more insights into this. Witches are not aggressive towards villagers or iron golems, with a few exceptions we'll talk about later. Iron golems, on the other hand, will attack witches. Even so, witches won't defend themselves, preferring to die over inflicting damage on a village. This hostility dynamic implies an asymmetric relationship between witches and villagers. Witches mean no harm, but villagers see them as a threat. You may be seeing where I'm going with this. The witches are villagers that have been outcast from the village. This may also be the case for the illagers, but the difference here is that the illagers are thinking bigger, and they don't even want to live in the villages, choosing to destroy them instead. On the other hand, the witch doesn't appear to hold a grudge against the villagers, and wants to be accepted. At the very least, she's indifferent towards them. If it's true that the witch is an outcast, the next thing we need to determine is the reason. The obvious answer to this question is that the witch was banished for witchcraft. However, we need to be careful with this, and make sure we know what witchcraft actually is. We may initially think that it's the manufacture of potions. What makes this complicated is that there's a villager profession that, on the surface, is extremely similar to a witch. The cleric. Clerics also deal with magic, and they're the only profession to brew potions. This is made clear by the brewing stand in their house, as well as their available trays. They request items such as glass bottles, nether warts, and rabbit's feet, and they sell things like redstone and glowstone. So is potion brewing really witchcraft? That doesn't seem to be the case. If it were, then clerics would also be banished along with witches. It seems as though we've hit a dead end. What are the witches doing that make villages dislike them? The fact that they can defend themselves with complex potions should make the villagers want to keep them, not kick them out. So what's going on here? To find the answer, we need to approach the situation from a different angle. What are potions useful for? There are essentially two categories, offensive and defensive. Offensive potions are used on other entities, such as a splash potion of harming or poison. Defensive potions are drunk by the user and include potions like a potion of health or a potion of swiftness. Witches will use both types of potions. In fact, they have an arsenal of 8 different potions for various situations, 4 offensive potions and 4 defensive potions. This is one thing that separates witches from clerics, a knowledge of a wide variety of possibilities. But that in and of itself proves nothing. Again, wouldn't knowing more things be a benefit for a village? We're missing something here. The answer is tough to find. In fact, I sort of misled you a minute ago by creating a false dichotomy of potion uses. Although offensive and defensive potions are by far the most common uses, there exists a third, somewhat obscure case. This is the transformation of a zombie villager to a regular villager. How does that work? Well, first the zombie villager needs to have the weakness status effect, which can only be done by brewing a weakness potion. Then, giving the zombie a golden apple will cause it to begin its transformation back into a regular villager. After a few minutes, the zombie villager will be completely cured. The mechanics of this seem to be complex, as it requires deep knowledge of how zombification works. This is a huge topic, and I'll save it for another video. For now, though, we just need to recognize that zombie villager curing is a third use for potions. And it's certainly an atypical case. Someone who hasn't seen it before would be likely to misunderstand what's happening. Among the player base, zombie villager curing is pretty common. It's a great way to get cheaper trading deals. What's less well known, however, is that there's an example of this found somewhere in the Minecraft world. If you don't know it's there, you may never find it. In fact, I've talked to many people who didn't know what I'm about to say. There's a generated structure that occurs in snowy biomes called an igloo. It's pretty unassuming. It contains a bed, a furnace, a crafting table, and a redstone torch so as not to melt the ice. But it holds a secret. Half of all igloos have a trapdoor hidden underneath the carpet. The ladder leads down to a second room, hidden deep underground. This room contains 2 cages, one with a villager and one with a zombie villager. As we look around, we find more stuff scattered about. There's a cauldron and a brewing stand, which contains a single potion, a splash potion of weakness. In the chest, we find typical villager stuff, such as wheat and coal. There's something that sticks out, however, a golden apple, which spawns 100% of the time. Someone was using this igloo to experiment with zombie villager curing. They've clearly found the solution. The splash potion of weakness combined with the golden apple will cure the zombie. There's even a sign with arrows showing the connection between the two. So we know that someone in the Minecraft universe was trying to solve a serious problem for the villagers. If one villager was infected, a village could quickly become overwhelmed by zombies. We see examples of this with zombie villages that spawn sometimes, where the entire population has been zombified. There is clear motivation for finding a cure. Iron golems can protect against zombies, but they're not really a solution to the fundamental issue, which is that a villager is physiologically weak to zombification. So who was it that took on this challenge? Examining the structure offers some clues. Once again, the design is really similar to a village house, this time like the igloos we can find in tundra villages. Just like every other house, there's a bed, as well as a workstation in the form of a furnace and crafting table. What makes this different, however, is that the igloo contains a secret second workstation in the basement, which is the brewing stand. If we dig a little deeper, we find that the furnace isn't actually a real workstation. Butchers use smokers and armorers use blast furnaces, but none of them use the standard furnace. In fact, if we start smelting some items, it soon melts the ice block on the igloo wall. It seems as though this furnace has not been used a single time, or else someone would have discovered this critical design flaw. The furnace in the igloo is truly a decoy block, designed to make other villagers think that it's being used. In reality, the basement is where the true work happens. The most likely candidate for the worker is the cleric villager, as suggested by the brewing stand. Furthermore, the chest can contain gold and rotten flesh, both of which can be sold to clerics. Now we have all the facts in front of us, and we can begin to piece them together. Here's the story of what happened. In the early days of villages, they were attacked constantly by zombie hordes, posing a huge threat if even a single villager was bitten. There was a cleric villager who recognized this as an issue, and she wanted to see if her potion brewing abilities could be used to cure zombie villagers. So she built an igloo some distance away from the village in order to offer some protection. Since her experiments involved zombies, the cleric didn't want to accidentally infect her home village. She took every precaution, including building the lab deep underground to reduce the chance of a zombie escape. The villagers probably thought that this cleric was eccentric, but not necessarily a threat. The decoy furnace ensured that they wouldn't get too suspicious or worried about the experiments. The cleric continued her work deep underground, and eventually she stumbled upon the solution and learned that it was possible to transform a zombie villager back to a normal villager. It was a great success. Now the villagers would no longer need to be afraid of being infected. All it took was a simple potion and a golden apple. The cleric excitedly returned to the village to share the news. Curious, a couple of the villagers went with the cleric to the igloo. The cleric revealed the trapdoor and brought the villagers underground. But instead of being excited, the villagers were shocked and unsettled. They saw a caged villager next to a zombie. Was this cleric trapping innocent villagers and creating zombies? Why wouldn't they release the villager that had been cured? And why was the cleric being so secretive? The villagers assumed the worst. The cleric was clearly experimenting with the undead, trying to find a way to spread the zombie disease through potions. And before the cleric had a chance to explain how the curing process worked, the villagers fled, returning to civilization to share the terrible news. The rest of the villagers were deeply unsettled by the cleric's alleged actions. They made a collective decision. Any clerics involved in this dark study would be banished from the village. They instructed their iron golems to treat them as enemies, and the villagers cut off all communication with the offender. The cleric was confused. Why had the villagers run away before she could show her great discovery? She walked back to the village to see what was happening, but suddenly she was attacked by the Iron Golem, a being she had once known as a kind protector. The village had just exiled her, but why? What had she done wrong? The cleric realized that she had no choice but to flee far from the village. So the cleric did just that, using her potions to protect against the dangers of the outside world. The cleric eventually settled down, far, far away in a swamp biome. She knew that no villagers would dare traverse these smelly waters and that she would be safe. And the cleric constructed a simple hut to live in. As time continued, the cleric slowly began to shed the customs and rituals of the villagers. Instead of eating bread, she began to grow mushrooms for mushroom stew. She removed her traditional cleric garments in favor of a flowing robe. She donned a new black hat, giving it one emerald to remind her of the past. She kept a black cat so she could have a friend. With nothing else to do, the witch would occasionally roam the world, hoping to find that one villager who would tell her story and allow her to return to civilization. The witch would occasionally come into contact with the illagers, who were similarly outcast. However, the illagers were much more aggressive towards villagers, conducting patrols and raids. They welcomed the witch to participate in such activities whenever she wanted, and although the witch didn't want to hurt the villagers herself, she secretly found some joy in watching them suffer. So she came to some raids, healing the illagers but never actually attacking the villagers. Perhaps it was a way for her to show how she could have been useful if only the villagers had given her a chance. But now, it was far too late. She was just too different. The villagers would never allow her back into society again. So that's the story of the witch. Unlike some of the other deep dives, this one's pretty sad and depressing, with the story of a creative mind being outcast due to ignorance. As with all theories, we need to review it and see if there are any leaps of faith we've taken or things that we've missed. There's one thing about the witches that's hard to understand. Where did they get their ingredients? If we look at the 8 potions that witches can brew and compare it with their drops upon death, we find that there are several ingredients that are missing, including pufferfish, glistering melon, magma cream, and most importantly, nether warts. The last 3 require access to the nether, and there's no evidence of any overworld mob being able to do that in the present day. This is a tough problem that doesn't have an easy answer. In fact, clerics have a similar issue because brewing stands require blaze rods to craft. With no modern access to the nether, where did this come from? One potential solution is that after the nether portals were broken, some nether ingredients still remained in the overworld. The brewing stand may have been passed down for generations, for example. Not all villages have one either, which is further evidence for its rarity. In fact, swamp huts don't even have one, just a cauldron. Maybe a more important question is, how do the witches even brew potions without a potion stand, much less nether ingredients? I will offer one solution. Remember how in the Illager video I said that the purpose of their raids was to charge their totems with experience? What if the witch's hat is the same way, and it's what allows them to brew potions without a brewing stand? It's not as big of a stretch as one might think, given that one accepts my Illager theory. The green on the witch's hat may not be an emerald, but rather a part of the experience storage, similar to the green eyes on the Totem of Undying. It also provides motivation as to why the witch would help illagers on their raids, in order to charge their hat to make potions. We already know that the illagers can use experience for crazy magic, such as summoning ghosts. There's no reason they couldn't also create a hat which allowed the witch to brew potions without all of the ingredients. So maybe that explains it, maybe not, but I think it's a possibility that could make sense. Another question is, why does lightning transform a villager into a witch? Lightning has some really bizarre properties, and honestly, this is something I need to address in a separate video. Still, it's worth pointing out that this theory doesn't necessarily explain how that works. So there we go. That's my theory about the witches. I'm not claiming that this is absolutely correct. Rather, as with all of my deep dives, the point of this video is to start a discussion and get the community thinking about the facts and what conclusions we can draw. Let me know what you think in the comments. If you're interested in a deeper discussion, join the Discord. We have a great community talking about Minecraft theories. I'll end with that. This has been Retro Gaming Now. Thanks so much for watching, and I'll see you all in the next video. Have a great day.